So thank you to everybody who survived to the last lecture, where I'm gonna first of all complete the calculation of the Higgs coupling to, I mean, to the relevant Higgs couplings for the LHC measurement, and we are almost there with the last one, which is the coupling to the fermions. So. Yesterday we saw how to write an effective Lagrangian for the top. Well, in general, if you buy this picture for all the families, for all the third family uptype, sorry, for all the uptype quarks, and this was a generalized Yukawa Lagrangian that contains two powers of the, I mean, two fermion fields and an arbitrary number of Higgs field insertions. Which was encapsulated in this global symmetry group invariant operator Q bar T left dressed singlet top right singlet dressed, okay, which we constructed using basically the CCWZ technology of putting the Goldstone matrix inside these source fields, which are complete five-plet, but then you dress them with the Goldstone matrix, and this gives another five-plet that, however, you can split into four-plet and singlet component. And this is the singlet component, which is in itself invariant, and so this thing is completely invariant under the group, under the full G equal to S of 5 group. Okay, so that is the full realization of the full symmetry, only realized in a nonlinear way. So I had still to write the coefficient of this operator. This operator, you see, contains the fermions and also the X, which comes in the Goldstone matrix that is hidden in this dressing thing. And so the first thing it will be a mass term when the X takes a web for the top quark. So after all, the coefficient I'm going to write in front of here doesn't matter much because it will be reabsorbed in the definition of the top mass. It will be fixed by reproducing the top mass. However, this coefficient can be parameterized like this. There is an order one number C top. Then there is a scale, because this is like a mass term, so it has to have dimension one, and so there is M star, the typical scale of the composite sector. And then there's going to be the couplings of the source with the composite sector. The Q left source was coming with lambda T left, the T right was coming with lambda T right, okay? And so whenever one of these things enter, there should be together its own coupling. And finally, there is in the denominator here something that I'm going to explain you the origin of in a few minutes. And it is the usual G star. Okay, I will discuss it in more details. So G star was this typical coupling of the composite sector that was somehow entering in our estimates. And here it comes to the second power. Okay, you can rewrite this in the unitary gauge, leading to the same prefactor times the following function, which is 1 over 2 square root of 2, the sine of 2v plus h over f, t bar left, t right. Okay? So v is the web, so h is the fluctuation. When h is equal to 0, this, the first thing this does is to give a mass to the top quark, okay, which you can read from here. It depends on this, still on this Ct coefficient, so mt is equal to, if you want it explicitly, Ct lambda t left lambda t right over g star square m star root square of xi 1 minus xi divided by square root of 2. Okay? All right, doesn't matter. Whatever it is, it will be fixed by this Ct. Okay? Of course, we would like Ct to be of order 1, so this combination, lambda t, g star, etc., they should be rather, these lambdas in particular should be designed in a suitable way such that this is the order of magnitude of being the top mass. Okay? Fine. But once I've done this, I can re-express the coefficient Ct in terms of the top mass and get definite predictions. Okay, so now I get something like minus mt over 2, 1 over root square of xi, 1 minus xi, sine of 2v plus h over f, and then there is t bar left, t right, or if you want, a Dirac mass term for the top. Okay, so of course in the standard model you would just have found, rather as usual, rather than sine of 2v plus h over f, you would have found just v plus h over f, sorry, v plus h, okay? So you would have just find v plus h rather than this complicated trigonometric function. So this will deliver, expanding this in powers of h, will deliver couplings of the Higgs to tops, but with a modified strength. And this I can immediately show by expanding this in H. So I will find the first term, which is the top mass, mt t bar t. Then there is minus a parameter I call kt. And here I will encapsulate the differences with respect to the standard model. So mt over v, that's the linear term, t bar t. And then there are also higher powers of the Higgs that come from expanding, which of course are not present in the standard model. And so there are new couplings like C2 m of the top divided by b square h square t bar t, for example. And so kt is the modification of the top core coupling, so it's the coupling Higgs top in composite Higgs normalized to that of the standard model, which if you compute it, you find it 1 minus 2 Xi over root square of 1 minus Xi, okay? So as usual, it's something that for Xi goes to 0 goes to 1, but otherwise, when Xi is not dramatically small, there is not so much fine-tuning, it must deviate with respect to the standard model prediction, and this is something you can measure, okay? Also at the LHC. Another thing that you can measure at the LHC you will be able to measure at the LHC with some accuracy is the possible presence of this C2 coupling, which is an interaction involving two top quarks and two Higgses, okay? This will be perhaps measurable in double Higgs production with some error bars. And the value in this case is C2 equal to minus 2 Xi, okay? So it's a direct sign of new physics as it involves an operator which, as you see here, has dimension 5, okay? Okay, so so this was for so right now we have an almost complete picture of the Higgs couplings. The Higgs couplings are measured mainly by Higgs production cross section time branching ratio, as you've seen in the Michael Peskin lectures, and so you know that they are measured together. Okay, so you measure together the coupling to the vectors, the coupling to the fermions, to the top and to the bottom. So we do already have a prediction for the deviation of the coupling to vectors, which we called KV, which is square root of 1 minus xi, which we determined at the very beginning of these lectures. This prediction, okay, is completely universal, so it only depends on the choice of the coset S of 5 over S of 4. Next we have this one, okay, this one written here, which instead is more model dependent. So in particular, the one I called here KT should actually be called KT 5, okay? So it's the prediction of the modified top coupling obtained in the 5 representation, and is this 1 minus 2 xi over root square of 1 minus xi, okay? But this could be changed in another representation. For instance, we saw that the 4 representation, even though disfavored, I tell you this is disfavored, it also could work for generating the top mass, and this gives to a kt 4, which is slightly different, is square root of 1 minus xi. Okay? So when you move xi in the plane, if you want kt, kv, this corresponds to a different trajectory. Okay? And in principle, if we are able to measure these deviations well enough, we can distinguish between this option or this other option. To make actual prediction, you also need the coupling to the bottom quark and its modifications. Now for the bottom, well, again, there is some ambiguity depending on which kind of representation of the composite operators you use to give mass to the bottom. However, for the most common examples, you have, if you have the top in the 5, you also have the bottom in the 5. And so what happens is that in all cases that are commonly studied in the literature, okay, there are counterexamples, what happens is that kappa b is always equal to kappa t, okay, even though it's not strictly needed, okay? So basically, the deviation of kappa of the bottom and top cappings are the same, and so they can be encapsulated in a unique correction, kappa f, which is what our experimentalist colleagues like to do, of course, for simplicity, to have a fit to the x cappings involving only two parameters, which is kappa v and kappa f. Okay? So I can show you the result of this little exercise overlaid with the current experimental data. Okay, which is over there. So you see that these lines correspond to the so this is the standard model, okay, in the plane kappa v kappa f, and this is the minimal compositeness model with 4 representation. Okay, this is the one with the 5 representation. So you see they are a little bit tilted. Okay, you also see that the error bars are, this is 1 sigma, for instance, are relatively large still, as you can expect. The X has just been discovered. CMS is this blue curve here and is somehow generous with composite X. Okay? It allows a lot of values of size. Atlas is more moved on the right, and so you see that at 2 sigma is already capable to exclude from 0.1 from, let's say, 0.15. Okay? So so that's one of the constraints we do have on composite X. As of today, even though it's probably not the strongest one, okay? But I think it's the simplest one to get, and that's why I decided to derive all these couplings for you. Okay? Is there any question? Sorry. Yes. Atlas. Yeah. Good question. So the question was whether so the fact that Atlas is preferring larger couplings with respect to the standard model, and this is true, and whether the composite X unavoidably gives smaller, as it does, you see. Now, for any composite X with a compact coset, it's typically going to be the case. Any composite X with a compact coset is going to be the same. There are examples of composite X based on non-compact cosets, like the complexified version of SO5, which then have something like, 1+, okay? Exactly. It is also true when you play this kind of games that you have to take into account that here we are assuming that there is only one Higgs doublet. So we are doing the minimal composite Higgs model where there is only one Higgs doublet. But actually, it's sufficient to imagine a bit larger coset to have more Higgs particles. Okay, one doublet, one singlet, and then you will have a more complicated phenomenology because these extra Higgses can mix with the other ones, and so can back-react in that plot in a non-trivial way. So that plot, if you want, is made on the assumption that the direct searches of other scalars will have no result, will have null results, so these other scalars are very heavy, and so they do not mix, because otherwise these results, if you want, these predictions will be contaminated by new effects whose sign and direction is a bit difficult to predict. Okay? Okay, so now I want to move to the last piece of information that you need if you want to understand a paper on composite X. which is called the power counting. Okay. So the what is a power counting? A power counting is a systematic way to estimate the size of operators in effective Lagrangians. Okay. And the power counting then reflects an assumption on the UV theory, okay, on the way it behaves generating these low energy effective operators. Power counting is needed for at least two reasons. If you look at for instance, the predictions we derived until now, right? You derived the top Yukawa Lagrangian prediction. Similarly, we derived the coupling of the X2 vectors coming from the gauge field mass terms and so on. In that case, we have been rather lucky because in both cases, the prefactor of this single operator was fixed. In this case, it's fixed by the fact that you have to reproduce the top mass. So it's matched, if you want, the coefficient of the effective operator to phenomenology. But you do have clearly corrections. Okay, for instance, to this formula, you may consider the effect on the X2 top coupling modifications due to higher derivative operators, operators involving not only fields, but also derivative acting on the fields, which will change the kinetic term and so back reacting different couplings. And in general, there are several sources of corrections to these leading order results that you need to estimate. And in order to estimate them, you need an estimate of the effect of the operators that you have neglected at this leading order level. And for this, you need an estimate of their size, which is power counting. And also another very important thing is that there is not only Goldstone bosons and standard model fermions in this theory. We saw that there are plenty of resonances of new particles whose dynamics cannot be just fixed by the nonlinear sigma model predictive power. Okay, so the sigma model constrains these dynamics, but it really doesn't tell us specifically one Lagrangian with all its coefficient. And also to estimate the size of the couplings and the interaction strength of these resonances to be found at the LHC or to be searched for at the LHC, you need this power counting rule. Okay? So there is one specific power counting which is done in these theories, which is called one scale, one coupling power counting, or it's also called Silch power counting from the paper called Strongly Interacting Light Higgs, where this was introduced in this framework. And this power counting is as follows. And so the way this power counting works can be easily illustrated by, again, our first example of a composite X theory in terms of a linear scalar theory. Okay? So if you go back to your notes, you should discover that the Lagrangian that we have takes, the following form, okay? So there is the kinetic term for sigma, there is the mass term for sigma, and the mass term of sigma, even though it was not written in that way at the beginning, is like this, okay? So there is a mass for sigma, which we called M star, and it is G star times F. G star was that coupling parameter that was appearing in the original potential. Remember, it was G star square over 8, no, 5 square minus f square, okay? So the original Lagrangian was written in terms of g star and f, but now we can rewrite it in terms of m star, okay, and g star. And then if you do this, you discover that this is, so that's the mass term, that's the interaction term, which is g star over 2 times m star sigma cube, okay? So a trilinear sigma interaction is weighted by the coupling G star, not surprisingly. It is dimensionful, so it has also an M star. Then there is the quartic coupling, which is just G star square over 8, sigma to the fourth, which has 2 power of the coupling, corresponding that this is a 4 power of fields interactions. And then there was all the complicated stuff, including the Higgs, which we can see the Higgs or the Goldstones, which you can rewrite as 1 plus G star sigma over M star. So here you had at the beginning sigma over F, but I just traded it by M star and G star, square, multiplied by that complicated expression, which, however, altogether was the pure pion or Goldstone Lagrangian, okay? So let me call it, let me call all these L pi. Okay. For the time being, let's focus on the gauge-less situation. So let's do everything when the gauge couplings G and G prime are equal to zero. Okay, we will introduce them later. And so here in this Lagrangian, there are just fields and ordinary derivatives, and there is no gauge fields. And this Lagrangian L pi, even without writing the complicated form it had, you can check that, I mean, schematically, it is of the following form. It is F square in front of it. Then there are two derivatives in all the terms that we have, okay? So D square. And then there is pi, okay, weighted by F, okay? All this to an arbitrary power. Actually, it was even a trigonometric function, so you should imagine expanding it, okay? It has this structure. This structure, remember, came from the fact that the Gurdon matrix depends only on pi over f, but in front of this you have an f squared prefactor, okay? Then you have two derivatives, and this is what you get, okay? So all the terms in this thing have this form, okay? And you can express this in another way, okay? Again, using f and g star M star relation, you can find that the full composite sector Lagrangian as written here takes the following form. So if you check term by term, so both the terms involving sigma and pi, they obey the following structure. So there is M star to the fourth over G star square, okay, which I factorize in front of everything. And then there is a dimensionless polynomial of interaction, okay? So this is a functional, which contains a derivative weighted by M star, okay? And the fields, okay? And the fields are weighted by G star pi over M star, okay, which just means pi over f, and g star sigma over m star, okay? Okay, so what we can say about this Lagrangian, about this structure, okay? That is going to be our power counting formula, which now we're going to justify in some details. First of all, we recognize that it's not surprising that pi and sigma enter into the interactions in the same way, because they are both composite particles, okay? And it's also, if you want, not surprising that the only scale that enters in the problem, and there is only one scale, okay, which is the strong sector scale, M star. And the only thing which is surprising is the way in which I'm placing these G star couplings, which for the moment you may not see why it is so. Okay, we can just verify that this form matches with the explicit Lagrangian written on the other side, which is then a trivial exercise. However, it's a bit trivial to check that this structure of the Lagrangian preserves, is maintained, okay, survives. If you play a little bit around for this Lagrangian. Suppose, for instance, that you want to compute the low-energy effective field theory only for the Gurdon fields, okay, obtained by integrating sigma out, okay? Okay? So I integrate out sigma, and I get another Lagrangian. And this Lagrangian happens to be of exactly the same form. I can verify this very easily. So to integrate out sigma, the first term which I find is just the term when I just set sigma to zero in all places. So the first term of this effective Lagrangian is the one we used already, okay? So it's just the Gurdon Lagrangian. And it's a two derivative term. So it's an L2, okay? Which is just coincide with the old Gurdon Lagrangian L pi, okay? Which, if you look at it and you compare with that, you see that it has exactly the right form to match our expectation. Then you have another term which starts with 4 derivatives and the one at 6 derivatives and so on. And the one at 4 derivatives, let's look how it's obtained. So Lagrangian 4 derivative is like this. You integrate out sigma, and so the only interaction of sigma with the Goldstone comes from the square of this term. When you take the mixed product, you have something like 2g star over m star sigma multiplied by all these L pi Lagrangian. And so, so diagrammatically, this means that the 4 derivative Lagrangian comes from this diagram here. There is an L pi blob here that couples with sigma, and another L pi on the other side, with the sigma field propagating in between. Here there is the sigma propagator, but I'm constructing a low energy effective field theory, so this will just be minus 1 over m star square when I expand the propagator. And here I just have the strength of the interactions, which I read from that formula, from the mixed product, is like 2g star over m star square, because there are two such vertices. Then there is 1 over m star square. Then there's going to be some numerical coefficient. And then there's going to be L pi square. Okay. See, now it's a 4 derivative Lagrangian, because each L pi contains 2 derivatives. And if you remember that L pi Lagrangian is itself of this form, okay, so you have that all this is g star square over m star to the fourth, so times L pi, right? L pi obeys this rule, so it is itself of order m star to the fourth, that then goes to the eighth over g star square that becomes to the fourth. And then it's the product of two polynomials that I will just write it as one, L hat of d over m star, g star pi over m star, g star sigma over m star. Okay? So if you simplify things, this 8 becomes 4, and this 4 becomes 2. Okay? And so you recover that even the higher derivative order Lagrangian has the form predicted by, has the form dictated given by that power counting over there. So somehow the structure of the power counting persists if you integrate out one or some resonances out of this more complicated Lagrangian. If you like to do so, you can go on. For instance, you can look at the dimension 6 Lagrangian, which comes from two contributions. The first one is when here I pick the first term in the expansion of the propagator, which is p square over m star square down with respect to that. P square are derivatives, so this is exactly two more derivatives and two more m stars, so it still obeys this formula here. There is another term in the L6 Lagrangian, which is also schematically like this, so you have a vertex with three sigmas and blobs attached, and so you can check that this is dimension 6, and this also fits into this formula. Okay. Okay, now, so the nice thing about this power counting is that it can be justified in completely different directions, and only the simplest one will be actually explained here. But the second one is more interesting, okay? But let's go to the first one. So, one way I can understand this formula is in terms of dimensional analysis, okay? But not just the natural units dimensional analysis, okay? So what I'm going to do is, for a minute, is I'm going to forget h bar. So I'm going to take h bar different from c, different from 1, okay? And I'm going to do dimensional analysis in the old-fashioned way, where you do have three fundamental units, which are length, mass, and time, okay, that you can trade for, which is more convenient for us, length, time, and energy, which of course is mass, length square over time square. Okay. In these units, the Planck constant, of course, is not dimensionless. The reduced h-bar Planck constant has the dimension of energy times time. And, well, and this dimension happens to be, of course, the same dimension of the quantum mechanical action. You know, in the path integral, you always have e to the I action over h-bar. And so this must be dimensionless, no, the exponent. And so we know that the dimension of the quantum mechanical action is the same as h-bar of, that is, aet. Okay? Okay. Furthermore, I know that, so from here I can read the dimension of the Lagrangian density. Okay? So the action is the integral in d4x of the Lagrangian density. D4x is always defined, so x is always defined to be ct, x mu, sorry, x vector, okay? So each of these x has actually a dimension of length, okay? So the dimension of this d4x is length to the fourth, and thus the dimension of the Lagrangian density is the dimension of s, which is the dimension of h-bar, divided by length to the fourth, okay? And furthermore, always because of this fact that x has dimension length, derivatives have dimension 1 over length, okay? So this is trivial, and then it's also trivial to see what are the dimension of canonically normalized fields. For instance, a scalar field, okay, has a kinetic Lagrangian, which is d phi square. Right? And so its dimension must match with the dimension of a Lagrangian, must match with the dimension of h bar divided by L to the fourth. And so the dimension of a scalar field is equal to the dimension of h bar to the 1/2 over length. Okay? We normally say that the field has dimension of mass, which is true in natural units. Indeed, here we find 1 over length, which is equal to mass in natural units. But if you are more precise, there is also the square root of the h-bar dimension. By the way, the gauge fields have the same dimension, because the vector fields have always a Lagrangian with two derivatives like this. The fermions are a bit different, because for the fermions, the kinetic term contains only one derivative, right? So you have psi bar d slash psi. And so for the fermions, you have that the dimension of a fermionic field, okay, is h bar to the 1/2. You see there is always h bar to the 1/2, because kinetic term is always quadratic in the fields. But the power of L is different, corresponding the energy in natural units is different, and it's L to the 3/2. Okay. I'll keep this here. So this suggests that, well, in the first place, we should define a symbol for this h-bar to the 1/2 dimension that enters in all places. So actually, we will define a coupling dimension, C, which is the dimension of h-bar to the minus 1/2, okay? And so we can start now reading the dimension of the various objects that we have typically in our Lagrangian. For instance, the dimension of the electric charge, okay? The electric charge appears in the interaction of QED, like E, psi bar, A slash psi, okay? And you can count this dimension, okay? And compare it with the dimension that the Lagrangian has to have, okay? And so this one you impose to be equal to H bar over length to the fourth, which means 1 over coupling square, 1 over length to the fourth. And so you discover that the electric charge has dimension C. and that's why I call it a coupling dimension. Okay? So the electric charge in non-natural units is not a dimensionless object. It has a dimension, which are dc's, which are minus 1 over the dimension of the square root of h bar. And similarly, many other parameters of the standard model you are used to, and sometimes people regard them as numbers, they are not numbers, and this makes a difference. When you look at the calculation, you can immediately sometimes conclude if it's wrong or not by this coupling dimension analysis. For instance, the Yukawa coupling of the fermions, let's say the Yukawa of the top, is also a coupling. It's properly called a coupling. You can check by the same way. Dimension of something that is called a coupling, it's the Quartic-Higgs coupling, lambda for H, okay? It's not a coupling, it's a coupling square, okay? The reason being it appears like multiplies phi to the fourth and not a phi cube interaction, okay? And that's why, for instance, supersymmetric three-level relations between Higgs quartic and gauge couplings, given that the gauge coupling has dimension c, are never lambda equal to c, okay? Are always lambda equal to g squared, okay? Because of this. All masses have dimension of 1 over length in this thing. So, for instance, the mass of the W or the Z or whatever else has the dimension of 1 over length. Okay? And I could go on with several examples. But here, let's see why this is useful. It's useful because I can recover that formula by dimensional analysis. So we call theories of the type which have one scale. One coupling, if they happen to have only two dimension full parameter, okay, which are a scale, m star, which has the dimension of 1 over length, and the coupling, that is an object called g star, which has a dimension of c. And then you can see what the Lagrangian has to be just on the basis of dimensional analysis. Okay? For instance, the linear sigma model Lagrangian that we start, the usual LC, right? That's clearly one scale, one coupling Lagrangian in a trivial way. I mean, it's 1/2 d sigma d phi square potential. You see, no? The g square over 8 phi square minus f square, which is m star square over g star square. Okay, so you clearly see that here there is only one dimension for guy g star and another dimension for guy m star. Okay, so if you want, it's trivial that we got even after our complicated field redefinition, right, which was a bit complicated to perform, we got a Lagrangian that obeys that relation. Okay. As we will see, it's just dimensional analysis. There is a less trivial example, which are the five-dimensional holographic models, where in order to really get the couplings and to check that they obey that relations, you will need to go through some complicated Kaluza-Klein reduction in warped space, whatever it is, but that's also very simple, because in the five-dimensional models, you have one scale, which is the infrared, if you want, cutoff of the theory, is 1 over length, and you have a coupling, which is the five-dimensional coupling, which has not dimension, which is not dimensionless in length. In five-dimensional gauge coupling has a dimension of c l to the 1/2. You combine the two, and you indeed end up into one scale, one coupling paradigm, okay? So you understand that this immediately simplifies our lives in the way we can parametrically understand how the results of even complicated theories behave. Okay. So, but I still didn't get to the point to show you this correspondence, the fact that if there is only one scale and one coupling, the effective Lagrangian looks like this. I will do it immediately with an important specification. So I work in that hypothesis, and I also work at the three-level order. So I imagine having plenty of particles and stuff, like for instance in the complicated five-dimensional graphic models. I integrate them out, and I get an effective Lagrangian for the Gorsons and perhaps some of the resonances. When I do this at the three-level, there is no dimensionful parameter that appears, because at three-level there is no parameter. In particular, there is no h-bar, okay, that enters into the calculation. And so the result must have the correct dimension, just and this dimension should be reproduced by just these elements that we have here, m star and g star. And so you have a prefactor, which is 1 over length to the fourth coupling square, which is 1 over coupling square, which is the m star to the fourth over g star square. And then all the rest must be dimensionless. Dimensionless in all possible senses, okay? In the sense it must have zero length dimension, zero coupling dimension, and so that's what we wrote there, right? Derivative come with m star, okay? Fields, okay, given the dimension of the fields that we discovered over there, right? They have to come with g star to compensate for the coupling dimension, and then 1 over m star for the length dimension. And this is for all the bosonic fields. So g star sigma over m star, also g star pi over m star. Okay. The only ones which are different are the fermionic fields, because the fermionic field has a little bit different dimension. So for them, the true power counting formula is g star psi, fermionic, if you want, resonance field, divided by m star to the 3 halves. So this is a three-level result. I've been careful in stressing that because, of course, perturbation theory, so semi-classical expansion, introduces in the game another dimensionful parameter, which is h-bar itself, okay? So if you want to estimate the one-loop effect on this Lagrangian, suppose you have some operator in this effective Lagrangian that for some reason cannot come at three level. There are examples. In this case, its coefficient is a bit smaller, and the thing goes like this, the one loop contribution, well, it gets an h-bar, because we know how to count the powers of h-bar that enter into loops. There is one for each loop. Next, there is a 1 over 16 pi square that, it comes from the loop integral, unavoidably. And then there's going to be something which must match the dimension. And so you need the g star square. Remember that h bar has 1 over coupling square dimension. So you need two couplings to compensate. And then you put the g star square. And then on top of this, that's all the rest you needed before. So then star to the fourth, right, over g star square times lat. So there is basically a suppression of loop effects with respect to 3 that is this part here, okay, which if you now go to natural units in the end of the calculation, h bar equal to 1, is g star over 4 pi squared, okay, the usual loop factor suppression that if you want you can understand in this way. Okay. Also important is that this formula, the way I derived, and it's obvious from here, it really only holds for perturbatively or, say, semi-perturbative theories. Because, here I'm using the concept of these dimensions that have a different impact depending on the order in perturbation theory I go. I mean that if there is no perturbative expansion, which means that if g star over 4 pi is not smaller or possibly much smaller than 1, then it's clear that 3 and loop level contribution, they all come together, right? And so there is no way in which I can maintain this coupling dimension. If you want, the coupling dimension gets obscured by h bar that enters in all possible ways, okay? So that's the justification of the one scale, one coupling power counting for theories that have some weakly coupled regime, okay, at the resonance scale. From weakly coupled theory or resonances, that's what's going to happen. For completely strongly coupled theories, it's rather interesting. so that this could actually be true. Okay, so there is a, I mean, I'm not going to enter into this, but so large NC gauge theories, like QCD in the limit of a large number of colors, they are genuinely strongly coupled theory in the sense that the UV description of this is a strongly coupled theory. It goes through a point where the tough coupling, or where the coupling, the intrinsic coupling of the theory is for pi, it's non-perturbative. But there are powerful theorems that tell us that the coupling among the resonances, okay, is suppressed at large NC. Okay? And by these powerful theorems, it's possible to show that in some particularly relevant sector of these theories, in particular in the mesonic sector, the expected power counting rule for the interactions involving mesons, in particular, is exactly this one. Okay, and this result, is one of the of the robust evidence of the possibility of a duality between a weakly coupled theory and an underlying large NC strongly coupled theory. So I will just write this for you. So at large NC, you can actually demonstrate that you get the same parametric formula with a coupling, with an effective coupling, right? G star, an effective resonance coupling of 4 pi over square root number of colors, okay? So it becomes as weaker and weaker as the number of colors increase. And so as the number of colors increase, you can imagine, so you are legitimate to imagine a strongly interacting composite sector based on the genuine, say, strongly coupled dynamics, which, however, doesn't have maximal coupling, maximal non-perturbative coupling. It has some track of a weak coupling. Please. Can you speak loud? No, it doesn't. The question was whether it depends on tough coupling. It does not depend on tough coupling, yes. Because, it cannot depend on tough coupling because I'm in a regime where the tough coupling is 4 pi. It's non-perturbative, so it's like it was not there. But if you look, for instance, on the Coleman lectures or in the paper by Witten on baryons, there is a very, baryons at large NC, there is a very brilliant introduction to all this. Okay? There is not the 4 pi because the string person do not want to see the 4 pi. Okay? The question is whether the tough coupling, if you want, but it's not this that leads the 4 pi. Okay? I can tell you later. Okay? Okay. By this logic, we can also very easily complete this power counting formula for the other interactions which we haven't considered yet. So, for instance, let's write down here. We have introduced the gauge interactions, okay? And then it's clear that the gauge interactions which we introduced in the covariant derivatives basically have a form L int equal to G A mu, okay, the corresponding gauge coupling to the corresponding gauge fields times the global current these particles attached to. G, we said, is a gauge coupling, so it has dimension of C. And when you see an A mu field in your Lagrangian, you have also to attach a G, okay? So the combination that has to enter into your power counting is always G times A mu, okay, which is already dimensionless because this has C and this is C to the minus 1 from the coupling viewpoint, and all what you need to make it dimensionless is inverse length power, so you have M star, okay? So when you have an elementary field insertion accompanied with its own coupling G, then in the power counting here, you have to consider like this, okay? You have to consider G A mu divided by M star, rather than G star. And that's not surprising at all. It's clear that the composite sector has its own coupling G star, the elementary sector has a completely different coupling G, and so G replaces G star in this form. Okay. Similarly for the fermions. Now for the fermions is a bit more conventional, if what I'm going to tell you, because clearly the fermionic operators, we don't know how they are normalized, right? So we just wrote lambda f bar O, let's say, no? Elementary composite operator. The fermionic operator then can be normalized the way you like. You can reabsorb powers of G star here and there. So it's just conventional that we say that the elementary composite coupling lambda has a dimension of coupling, okay? Otherwise, you will find the appropriate powers of G star in all places. It would not be observable. But the important thing is that it has one of these dimensions. And so in this assumption, you do have that a fermion, like an elementary standard model fermion, interacts weighted by its own elementary composite coupling. So you have lambda f over m star in this expression here, in this Lagrangian here. Okay. The simplest application of all this is, of course, the estimate of the coefficient of the Yukawa of the top that I already anticipated. So the Yukawa of the top is a guy made of two elementary first, so elementary top left and top right, so let's say f bar left, f right. And then there is some complicated function of the, let's call it, f as well, function of the Higgs, okay, like this. So the Higgs must come, is a Gorston, so it must come with G star, so G star H over M star, which is of course H over F, okay, and the prefactor must be, let's say, M star to the fourth over G star square. I'm just applying the formula. And next, you're gonna have for each fermionic field, you're gonna have 1 over m star to the 3 halves because of their dimensions. So you have 1 over m star cube. And next, you have the elementary composite couplings, that is the lambda left and the lambda right. Okay, all this simplifies, and you find what we had at the beginning. So you find lambda left, lambda right over g star. M star. Okay? That's very simple. Okay, I want to show you a very simple application of this power counting rule to some phenomenology of some kind of resonant particles to be searched for at the LHC. You will see that it gives a rather non-generic prediction for this kind of particles. So we already discussed in general the arising of resonances, okay? So we know that there are resonances that are associated to operators. Operators of the composite sector give rise to resonances with the same quantum numbers. And here I want to briefly discuss vector resonances. Okay. But with vector, I mean spin one resonances. And to understand the spin 1 resonances, you first need to find out which are the corresponding operators. And the most appropriate operator for a spin 1 resonance is, of course, a Lorentz vector operators. And so these are the particles associated in particular to the global current. Operators. So for example, the global currents we are talking about are those of the composite X group SO5. And these currents, of course, you know, are in the adjoint of the group, which is the 10 representation. Okay. And we do expect resonances for each of these 10. And these resonances, the spectrum of these resonances, given that we have the spontaneous breaking SO5 to SO4, is going to be classified in terms of only SO4 representation. And so to read which particle I have to decompose the 10 representation into SO4. And this gives to me 3,1 plus 1,3. Which is the 6 of SO6, of SO4, you remember, plus the 4 plet, which is a 2,2 of resonances. Okay? We also have other global groups. We saw you have the U1X, for instance. Okay? And this leads to one singlet resonance, which of course is just a singlet of everything. But it has some non-trivial phenomenology, and also this has been studied at the LHC. Another thing which has been studied at the LHC in the vector resonance sector is the SU3 of color. Okay? Partial compositeness obliged us to introduce color as a global symmetry of the composite sector. And so this obliged us to have octet of resonances. Of course, SU3 is unbroken, so this will just show up as octets of colors. These last particles also have another name, which are called, they're called Kaluza-Klein gluons. Because the first place they arise this from was from Kaluza-Klein reduction of five-dimensional holographic like theories. Okay. So what I want to study here is one piece of this SO5, say 10 multiplet, and in particular this one representations here. So the particles which are, you see the decomposition, no? In the decomposition, this one is the adjoint of SU2 left, this one is the adjoint of SU2 right. So I want to study these particles here, which are those that correspond to the adjoint of SU2 left. They are in the 3,1, so they are triplet under SU2 left with zero hypercharge. So they are heavy vector, heavy resonance, one heavy triplet of resonances in the 3,0. Of the standard model group. Okay. These particles contain then 3 degrees of freedom, which get arranged into a rho zero, so into a neutral, I call it rho, the resonance, the vector resonance, and rho mu plus or minus. Okay. And I want to briefly summarize what we can tell about the phenomenology of these particles on the basis of symmetries and power counting. So as far as symmetries are concerned, I'm going to only use, for simplicity here, the linearly realized SO4 group. Okay? So I'm just going to write operators following not the full SO5, but only SO4, because it's easier, and in this case the result wouldn't change. SO4 acts in a simple way, so rho mu, which is this triplet here, can be written in a matrix notation as, if you want, rho mu 0 square root of 2 rho mu plus square root of 2 rho mu minus rho mu 0. And it transforms in the 3,1 of the SO4 group, which means that rho goes to G left, rho G left dagger. Okay, so it doesn't transform on the right, and it is in that joint of the left transformation. While we also have the other important element here is the X field, which I show you can be written as a 2x2 pseudo-real matrix sigma that transforms as G left sigma G left dagger. G right dagger. This one transforms with both. Okay. So these particles, from the viewpoint of the composite sector, will have a mass, okay, which we call m rho. of the order of M star, okay? If you want this trivial power counting analysis, they have a mass of the order of the confinement scale. They are, and so by using symmetries we can, and selection rules, we can first of all understand how they couple to the Higgs. Okay? So the coupling of these resonances with the Higgs will be entirely fixed by a unique parameter, because there is a unique operator which can mediate rho HH interaction, which is G, which is a coupling, which by power counting is of the order of G star over 2, I trace of rho mu, and then here there is sigma d mu with the two arrows, you know, which means acting on the right, and then minus the one acting on the left, the usual notation, sigma dagger. Okay. So SO4 symmetry tells us that there is a unique interaction of the rho with the two Higgses. And this already tells us a lot, okay, about the phenomenology of these guys. Michael Peskin told you about the equivalence theorem, right? And so you already know that inside the Higgs doublet, H equal to H up, H down, there are several interesting things. There is not only the physical Higgs, but there is also the longitudinal component of the W boson, okay, represented by a scalar, W left plus, which is just equal to H up. And there is also the longitudinal component of the Z boson that comes from the imaginary part of the H down. So you have something like V plus H over root square of 2, which then comes together with I Z left over root square of 2. Okay? So, and this is the longitudinal component of the Z boson. So given that I can control all this interaction with the Higgs, I can control all the interaction of the rho with the longitudinal vector bosons, and of course also with the physical Higgs boson here. And so I will be able to predict, as I will show you now in a second, all these interactions at the same time. So here I've written the VEV, okay, but the Higgs VEV doesn't matter much here because I am at such high energies that that I can neglect electroweak symmetry breaking. Electroweak symmetry is effectively unbroken. Okay. So you can work it out. You know what is sigma. You know what is H. And you can work out the couplings that you get out of here. Okay. So for instance, you're going to get something like GV rho mu zero, and you're going to get I W. Longitudinal plus d mu w longitudinal minus. So this vertex, minus the conjugate, minus I w minus longitudinal d mu w plus longitudinal. So this vertex mediates a decay process of the rho to w plus w minus. Okay. With the strength, which is a free parameter, is g star, okay? Is one of the free parameters of the composite sector, the typical strong scale, which we learned it needs not to be the maximal coupling, needs not to be 4 pi, is a free parameter of the theory. Of course, if this really has to be a strong sector, we would like this to be rather strong, okay? In particular, we would like this to be, 4, 5, 2, 3, okay? Then, the other pieces that, for instance, there is minus H d mu longitudinal Z plus longitudinal Z d mu H, okay, which mediates now the decay of the rho zero to X and Z, okay? But since it's the same coupling, the same operator that does it, okay, the transitions are just related, are just equal, okay? And so we are going to get predictions. Similarly, the rho plus, the charged component of the rho triplet, you can show it decays to wx or to wz, and the decay width are the same, okay, in all these channels. So we list all of them, gamma of rho 0 w left plus w left minus equal to gamma of rho 0 to zx equal to gamma of rho plus to wx equal to gamma of rho plus to wz. Now, if I did the calculation right, this should be, I can also compute the, give you the final number, which is g star square over 12 pi m star, or m rho, okay, the mass of this pi. Okay. So, provided g star is not extremely large, after which this particle should start becoming too broad to be seen, all these final states are being searched for at the LHC. So sometimes people wonder how we can test composite ticks, given that it's so vague, it's full of things that we cannot compute. I think I showed you that not only in the Hiss-Kabling modification, but here also on at the level of resonance production, we do have extremely sharp predictions. So in particular, this, all these different spectral boson channels can be studied at the LHC, and they happen actually to have even a comparable reach. And so having such a sharp prediction like that, the width, the partial width, and so the partial branching, the relative branching ratios are the same, okay, is an important constraint by which you can correlate different channels and make the search more effective, okay? Okay. The other thing which is, of course, very important for the phenomenology is the production rate, and also the branching ratio to leptons, given that these particles are also searched for in their decay to leptons. And to derive this, we can use our power counting again. So I want to consider the couplings with the light standard model quarks and leptons. Let's say light standard model fermions. Okay, those are the ones which are relevant, of course, for the production. And our power counting formula immediately tells us that a direct interaction between the rho and the quarks is extremely suppressed. Okay? And the reason is that in the formula, you do have the partial compositeness coupling associated with the light standard model fermions, not with the top. The one with the top are sizable, but the one with the light families, now we will see what they are, star rho over m star. Okay, here I'm applying the power counting formula, lambda q, let's say the quark, but it will be the same for the leptons, m star 3/2, lambda q, right, m star 3/2, okay? So this is lambda q, say square, divided by g star, rho, q bar, q. While I remind you that the Yukawa of the quark q, like for, it was for the top, is fixed like lambda q left, lambda q right, over g star, okay? So that's basically the same that we find here, okay? If there is not a huge hierarchy, which you don't expect it to be, between the q left and the q right composite couplings, that's basically you can estimate as the Yukawa coupling. Let's say the Yukawa coupling of the up or of the down of the quarks that are inside the LHC. So this is very, very small. Okay? So this term will not help us to produce the resonance at the LHC. The resonance at the LHC will be produced through another operator, for which power counting estimate is also, of course, needed. And this is a mixing. So there is a mixing in particular with the W boson. This mixing is just one allowed term in effective Lagrangian, so it's there. Of course, it's controlled by an unknown order one coefficient. You can normalize it like this, C over 2, then power counting, m star to the fourth over g star square. And the mixing is made like we have the standard model gauge field strength. We have to use the field strength because of SU2 gauge invariance. So W mu nu alpha okay? With its own coupling strength, which is the SU2 left coupling strength here, divided by m star square, because I have one W mu field and also one derivative, okay? And each of them costs an m star, so there is one of m star square. And then there is the rho. The rho comes with its own coupling, g star, rho. Well, rho, here I have to have two derivatives, so let me write this as rho mu nu alpha, okay? Which is the d mu rho nu minus d nu rho mu, divided by m star square. Okay? So that's the thing, which is just C over 2 G over G star, okay, W mu nu rho mu nu. Okay. So you see that this mixing is present and is going to mediate the interaction of eventually, it's going to mediate the interaction with the fermions, but you see already that it is a little bit suppressed by the presence of this G over G star. Okay, G is the electroweak coupling. This is the new strong sector effective coupling. So this thing is expected to be small. Okay, smaller than one. As how small or large depends on G star. Depends on this other coupling on this parameter that we see before, the one that controls the interaction strength with. With electroweak bosons. Okay. Now I will not bug you with the calculation of the vertex that comes from this. The calculation is very simple. There is a kinetic term mixing, right? And so you have to eliminate it before doing anything. And the simple way to eliminate it is to redefine the W field as W plus G over G star zero. Okay. And when you do this operation, you make the kinetic terms and mass terms, everything diagonal, very nice. But of course, you introduce from the usual W boson coupling to the quarks. Okay, there you spit out a term which is proportional to rho. So in particular, you in the standard model, you have something like W mu A G Q bar left rho T mu TAQ, okay? And when you do this operation, you do get from here a vertex with the quarks that it goes like G square, because there was a G also in front there are two G's, one is in front of the original vertex and the other comes from the shift, G squared over G star, okay? Rho mu A, Q bar, there is a C also, okay? Free parameter. Order one, Q bar left, gamma mu, TA, Q. Okay. So also in this sector, the coupling of this vector to fermions is completely predicted because it has exactly the same form as the SU2 standard model current. It is controlled by 1 second parameter. On top of G star, there is also this order one C. But aside of this, given that C is order one, that's extremely well predicted. It's predicted and it's also predicted to be rather small. One typical example of new physics theories are Z-prime models, which have typically a normalizable weakly coupled origin. And so you typically imagine that they do have a coupling to quarks, which is of the order, for let's say, of the electroweak couplings of G. Okay? Here you get a result, which is G over G star smaller. That, of course, is very important if you then go to compute the cross-section, because all this then enters still to the square when you compute the cross-section at the LAC. And so this makes that the production rate of this thing is rather small. If I have a second afterwards, I will show you the limits. The last thing is that by this vertex, I wrote it for the quarks, I could have written also for the leptons, and in general for all the fermions, from this formula I can also compute the partial width of the, say, rho plus going to fermion prime, which you can completely predict together with the width of the rho zero going to fermion anti-fermion. There is a factor of two, multiplicity between the two. And this is, well, it's the number of colors, which is there or not, depending on whether the fermion is a quark or a lepton. And then there is this suppression factor, g squared c over gv square, m rho or m star over 48 pi. So in comparison with the previous one, which is written here, which is, sorry, this is all g star, okay, which has g star square rather than this g square over g star, all these squares, it's clear that the branching ratio to fermions is typically small. So the gamma of the rho to fermions is much smaller than the one to vector boson. Okay. And so, in particular for large g star, and so the phenomenology is very simple. At large g star, you do have a reduced cross-section, which makes the thing more difficult to see. And the first place where you should see it at very large g star is in the diboson final state, because the branching ratio to diboson is much larger, while dileptons are much more difficult. So even if the search are rather accurate, are rather powerful, they are not yet there to see them. And well, I can show you a couple of plots if this thing works. And if you don't have some question in the meantime, please. That is not a Spurrier analysis. Spurrier analysis has to do with symmetries. In the end?
It's just some sort of background security, yes. Is it, how is it, how is it complete when we only use doing a Spurrier analysis when you gave a charge to a star and g star?
The question was about Spurrier analysis. I think you cannot give a charge to m star and g star in any meaningful way to obtain this. If you want, you don't have to give them a charge, you have to give them a scaling dimension, which is the coupling, okay? So giving a dimension to things is like allowing them to scale, one independently from the other, okay? And so I think the coupling counting is exactly doing what you're saying. But the Spurrier analysis is conceptually different. We also do it always in compositics, but it has to do with symmetries, okay? No, the symmetry here does not control everything. You see, the symmetry does not. The symmetry tells me these relations. The symmetry tells me that this branching ratio are related, this branching ratio are related, but it doesn't tell me how to estimate the relative size of the, I don't know, the branching ratio to fermions to the one to quarks. If you want, it's a dynamical information. Okay. Anyhow, this is an example of how we are how the LHC is searching for these resonances and what it's doing at the level of mass reach. The yellow thing here is the searches in dileptons, okay, two leptons final state, which, as you see, are very effective when this GV here means G star, okay? So when G star is 1, is of the order of the electroweak coupling, then there is not suppression, neither of the branching ratio to leptons nor of the production rate. And so the limit is very strong, is what our experimentalist colleague like to call the limit on vector resonances, which is 3 TV. But as you see, if you actually have the preference for a large G star, given that you are dealing with a strongly coupled sector, two things happen. First of all, the limit becomes much more weak because you have less cross section, and also this yellow curve loses predictive power, and you basically have to rely on the blue curves, which are searches into diboson final states. Okay. Overall, a plausible limit for the current ATV searches, let's say if you stick at GV around 3, which seems plausible for a composite sector, and it also complies with other considerations, the limit is of around 2 TV, which is not yet very much in trouble with respect to naturalness. And so the LAC instead at 14 TV will be the 13 TV will be able to say much more about this. And this is, for instance, shown here, where you have this small area here, which is the whole plot of before. You see, it ends up at around 3 TV. This is the 8 TV LAC. That's the LAC. Okay, that's the 300 investment bar at 14 or 13 TV. You see a small coupling, they really exclude extremely large mass, but still, I mean, it's capable to test composite ticks up to around, say, 3 TV if we take coupling equal to 3 as a reference. Okay, so that's gonna be. And also, you can notice here that more luminosity, which you could obtain by high luminosity, is not useless for composite ticks. Okay, it's typically meant to be useful for all possible applications, but in the case of composite ticks, it is not, because it doesn't do much in the, say, mass direction, okay, on this direction, but it does a lot in the coupling direction. Okay, when you increase this coupling, as we saw there, the coupling to quarks gets reduced, and so the cross section gets reduced. And discovering signals with small cross section is what high luminosity helps you in doing. And if you look at the other plot, you can imagine having a 100 TV collider, and that's the impact it would have, okay, in the mass coupling plane of, say, this vector resonance and in general of composite ticks idea. Oh, there is a question. The question is that there is the question is whether these masses should be really be at the TV scale. The answer is always the same. I find that, well, if you believe in fine tuning, well, I don't see. I mean, if you want to have a model where the Higgs mass is natural, which means that the Higgs mass is not only calculable in line of principle, but it's also calculable in concrete, okay, then you cannot have all this large fine tuning. And so your masses should be in the TV range, okay? Okay? But if you have other reasons to do composite ticks, which I don't know which one they are, there could be several. If you have other reasons, then you can go on for this also at FCC. Okay, good question. Good question. So the question was about electro weak precision test. I have here on the notes an estimate of electro weak precision test contribution that comes precisely from this resonance, but I didn't have time to discuss that. The situation with electro weak precision test is the following one. Electro weak precision test parameters which are relevant for this discussion are the S parameter and the T parameter. Probably Peskin lectures you saw what these things are. And the vector resonance, precisely by the coupling we already wrote down, gives a contribution to the S parameter, not to the T parameter because of custodial, and this is denoted here as this contribution, vector resonance contribution. Okay. Next, there is another effect which I mentioned quite a couple of times, that is, if you modify the X couplings, this back reacts into electro weak precision test by the radiative corrections from the standard model. And so this is this red thing here, depending on psi. Okay? So the thing is that this contribution goes in exactly bad direction with respect to how the ellipse is. You see, it goes really, standard model is just a little bit one sigma down here, and they go immediately very much away. So I would say that this psi is 0.25, which is depicted here, is probably excluded. And then, however, there is a further model-dependent contribution that depends on fermionic resonances. And this is denoted here as this line here, which basically may go in any direction, but it may also easily go back. So you see, on this plane, I'm not, say, working out here so that I cannot hope to go back, even with the resonance which is reasonably light. For instance, these lines here, okay, this black line here is the strict retro precision test bound from S on this resonance, okay? Okay, this corresponds to a certain length, if you want, of this vector contribution here. So 2TV is marginally inside what is not still completely excluded by the true precision test. Please. Beh, you see, if you work enough, in any model you can account for any signature. But it is clear that, I mean, just for example, a vector resonance decaying to die boson, like this one, has really no reason to be there in supersymmetry, while it has a reason to be there here. At the same time, it's clear that if I find this quark, I'm not denoting to composite X, okay? I don't think that would be, I mean, distinguish two such a different scenarios like supersymmetry and composite X will not be difficult, I guess. Of course, it will be much more difficult if supersymmetry or if composite X is discovered to characterize what exactly has been discovered, the details of the model, okay? That is gonna be much more difficult, and that would require 100 TV, probably. Okay? So just to tell you, I mean, the Atlas XS, who knows? You know, there is this little Atlas XS in the Dive boson searches. If this was, that was true, it's compatible with a resonance like this at 2TV. If that was true, then, I mean, at least for the first, I mean, at the beginning it would be obvious that this is on the composite side, not the supersymmetric side. But all the models that have gauge bosons, that have extra gauge bosons, depends, I mean, the origin that you want to give them. But if you give them a microscopic weakly coupled origin in terms of a gauge theory, okay, then they do not show this nice thing of the suppression of the coupling to quarks and to leptons. So they typically badly excluded by dileptron searches, okay, which doesn't mean that you cannot make them survive. For instance, they only couple to quarks and not to leptons. But then you have to start telling me why you want to play this game while the thing is like that. Now, yes, I think, I mean, we have questions, or...